Welcome to Inside View, and I'm Corey Burnell. I'll be your host for this episode. We're once again joined by our Congressman, Tom McClintock, and we want to welcome him. Thank you very much.
Well, Corey, once again, it's a real pleasure. Thanks for having me back.
Yeah, you bet. And we have so much more to cover in this episode as well. I hope our viewers have been able to see the other segments and can kind of catch up online, perhaps, if you weren't able to do that yet. Let's go ahead and start off with one of the important issues with the budget. And you had mentioned earlier about, you know, the most important piece of our national defense is the fact that we'd be able to fund it and our budget deficits that we're running. And this is a topic that's of concern to people right now as we see the saber rattling from North Korea, potential missile tests toward the United States, and then China's involvement and where they might go should we have to act. So can you speak a little bit to the conversation in the House and with the GOP and other Republicans about how this immediate threat might be seen and viewed and handled?
Well, first of all, we have to understand that America's anti-missile technology is growing every day. Our capabilities to stop such an attack grow every day. And our retaliatory capability is awesome. And the president has made it very clear that a hostile act by North Korea, such as launching missiles against Guam, would be met by a massive American retaliatory strike. I don't think it's any coincidence that shortly after he said that, Kim Jong-un backed off of his threat to fire missiles in the direction of Guam. I think that's very important to note. Also, our current defense spending is certainly more than adequate to the task. America spends more on its military establishment than the next eight largest military powers on the planet. And by the way, six of those eight powers are already our allies. Mm-hmm. The president has just asked for another and received $70 billion of additional – actually, he requested 50 and Congress sent him $70 billion of additional funding. That's like adding the entire military establishment of the United Kingdom to what we already have. The concern – is severalfold. First of all, there is waste in the military budget that we have to address, just as there is throughout the rest of the budget. For example, the Pentagon has said that their infrastructure is about 22% over capacity. They are asking for another round of BRAC, base realignment and closure, which they believe would save about $7 billion a year, $70 billion over the next 10 years. That's the price of two West Virginia class submarines, for example. Virginia-class submarines, for example. So even waste in the military budget needs to be attended. But our capabilities are awesome, and I think that's why Korea has now backed off its claims or its threats. I think they've been used to dealing with an administration that draws red lines and then does nothing. They're now facing a new administration that means what it says, and we're seeing what resolute application of military potential can do to protect our country. The concern is in coming years, if we continue on the spending trajectory that we have, more and more of our defense spending is being crowded out by other spending and ultimately by a growing interest cost that will exceed our defense spending within 6 years. Again, just renting the money we've already spent will exceed our defense spending in 6 years unless we change the overall spending trajectory. That's the big threat.
Is there any practical reason to have any concern that should North Korea become militaristic, that should they act on their militarism, that we would have trouble with China? We have such deep trade relations with China.
Well, that's actually a good thing because that gives the Chinese a big incentive to keep things cool. And the Chinese are the biggest patrons that North Korea has. And the president has worked very hard to engage China in this process as well as to engage the United Nations on the diplomatic front while making it very clear to North Korea's leader that we are prepared to retaliate if they strike first. Again, I don't think there's any coincidence that after he made that very clear, the North Korean government backed off. If I were in that North Korean government and looking at this madman Kim Jong-un, I'd be saying to myself, Do we really want him at the helm of this country running the kind of risks that he is running? Or maybe we should just get rid of him, and it wouldn't surprise me to wake up one morning and find out that's exactly what somebody has done.
Well, right. Now, if it would seem to me, and we've seen some columnists write, that should there be essentially a war with North Korea, that it would make sense.
Well, a war with North Korea would be, if you ever seen the great classic film Bambi Meets Godzilla, that's essentially what that war would be. Now, I don't mean to minimize it. They pose a serious threat to South Korea, but as far as our capabilities, there is no match.
Of course. And some columnists had said, well, if that were to occur, then really the end goal ought to be a reunification of Korea. Is that something that's discussed diplomatically in the halls of Washington as to, well, hey, if this is something that might need to be the end game if they become too aggressive of a threat?
But I think a lot of that's going to depend upon the wishes of the people of South Korea. They have done very well with freedom, and you know, ultimately that would be their decision whether to allow North Korea to rejoin them.
Mm. Yeah, it could be quite a burden.
Well, I mean, you've seen the aerial photographs of the peninsula from outer space at night. The South Korea is lit up bright. There's, you know, prosperity is obvious even from that distance, and North Korea is totally dark. They live in the dark ages. The South Koreans live and thrive in the 21st century of freedom. That's probably one of the best examples that you can find anywhere in the world between the difference between freedom and socialism when it finally plays out. That's a warning to countries like ours where we have a significant number of people who are flirting with socialism, but that's the difference when it plays out.
Yeah, it's tremendously discouraging at times when you see such stark examples, and yet so many of our very own countrymen don't get the message.
Yeah,
you kind of wonder what it is they're looking at.
They seem to think that socialism will work better in this country than everywhere else it's been tried. But, I mean, look around
just haven't
the world.
Done it right.
Free nations are prosperous. Socialist nations are impoverished. You know, look at what's going on in Venezuela right now.
Well, you know, on the subject of immigration, for example, what we see can be at times a lot of importation of socialist ideology, in that we particularly... If it swells the welfare rolls and the voting rolls of those who would like to see public
assistance. The difference. Well, that's the difference between legal immigration and illegal immigration.
Good clarification, right.
And there's a sharp distinction. Legal immigrants are those who come to our country because they believe in freedom. They want to raise their children as Americans. They want to see them succeed as Americans. They adopt a common language, a common culture, a common appreciation of American traditions and our constitutional principles. They obey all of our laws. They do everything our country asks of them. They wait patiently in line, sometimes for years. Those legal immigrants are a tremendous asset to our country.
Absolutely.
It is the illegal immigrants who thumb their nose at our laws, who try to cut in front of the legal immigrants. That's where we have the problems. That's why we have immigration laws. It's not to keep people out. It's to assure that when people come to our country, they come with that sincere desire to be Americans. They don't want to transform America into the country they've just left. They want to enjoy the fruits of liberty that America offers. The illegal immigrant population, and I don't want to generalize because I'm sure that there's a wide spectrum of folks within that, but when we tolerate illegal immigration, we undermine legal immigration, which is the very foundation of our nation of immigrants. If we're going to tolerate less, let alone reward illegal immigration, there's no purpose to having legal immigration, is there?
Certainly not. And on the issue of that concept of toleration and even protection of it, we see some cities naming themselves or becoming sanctuary cities, essentially trying to send the message to criminals, if you could define that as people violating the law, to come there illegally and disobey the law.
That is absolutely corrosive to the concept of the rule of law.
Right.
This is John C. Calhoun's pre-Civil War doctrine of nullification. This notion that a local or state official who doesn't like a federal law is perfectly free to ignore that federal law. That's what they're saying. That was the doctrine of nullification. That was resolved by the Civil War. And I never thought that I would live to see the day when that doctrine would suddenly rear its ugly head in modern America. That is frightening because it undermines the whole concept of the rule of law. It undermines the whole concept of a federal republic of under law.
Yeah, on that subject here, we have a U.S. Constitution that provides the power to the federal government to regulate immigration. And so you have a nullification of a federal law that certainly is in pursuit of legitimate federal power.
And by the way, there is a way to change that law. It is set forth in the Constitution. Mm-hmm. You have to convince a majority of your fellow citizens that it's the right thing to do. So we have plenty of ways for anyone who dissents from any of our laws to register that dissent and to work to change those laws. That is something very different from simply saying, I personally don't like that law, so I personally will not enforce it, I will ignore it, I will nullify it. That is very dangerous. And again, it's one of the most disturbing aspects of recent American politics to see the doctrine of nullification raised again in modern times. And by the way, and you go back to the same era, that was followed by secession, which is the ultimate rejection of our Constitution, our country, our rule of law, everything that they stand for. And today in California, there is a secession movement rearing its head, which, according to the Reuters poll in January, is supported by a third of Californians. Mm. That, too, is absolutely frightening and a throwback to the very bad days that produced the Civil War.
Well, when you see sanctuary cities completely flouting legitimate federal law here, mm-hmm. And you perhaps see the angst by liberals in California and looking at a solution they consider of secession, I mean, you generally find amongst the socialists in the country, and I'm going to do it even if it's against the law or the law doesn't approve of it mm-hmm. anyway. Mm-hmm. And we see this, if you can kind of speak to this attitude in the country that, well, if you're on the left, you can act a certain way, but it's not legitimate if you're on the right mm-hmm. to act a certain way, of a double standard of sorts. And so we see this being acted out by sanctuary cities, for
right.
example.
And it's absolutely corrosive to a country that's founded on the principle of the rule of law, equal justice under the law. That means the government cannot pick and choose who gets to live above the law and who has to obey the law. It doesn't get to pick and choose which laws to enforce and which to ignore. And yet that is the power that we are seeing asserted now on the American left.
Now, we have, obviously, this is federal law being flouted in this example of sanctuary cities. What can the federal government do to fix that type of problem? Because obviously we don't have federal police, per se.
Well, it ought to be an
locally.
Absolute no-brainer that if a local or state jurisdiction is refusing mm-hmm. to enforce federal law, they should not be receiving federal law enforcement funds. Mm-hmm. But I would go a step further and suggest that they should not be receiving any federal funds. And the federal government has every right to operate within those jurisdictions to enforce federal law.
Mm-hmm. Right. And have there been any examples of that where, say, ICE is acting and fulfilling its role in what's considered a sanctuary city?
Oh, yes.
In
fact, I think this administration has given priority to those jurisdictions that will not protect their own citizens. The federal government needs to step in and provide that protection as it pertains to federal law.
Mm, very interesting.
And again, there's nothing unusual or extra-constitutional about that. That is, the federal government has a certain sphere that is defined in Article 1 of our Constitution, mm-hmm. And it exercises supremacy within that sphere. And one of the powers is to establish the laws of immigration and right. to enforce those laws.
Right. Well, let's transition a little bit to a local issue we haven't gotten to cover in depth yet, and that was the our Resilient Federal Forest Act mm-hmm. that you've spoken on recently, and Here we have fire risk tremendously throughout your district, certainly up here in Calaveras County. We deal with it every year. Mm-hmm. Can you speak to a subject that I know a number of people are familiar with, that the underbrush and the fire risk?
Well, it's not that complicated. Up until about 40 years ago, we actively managed our forests. We made the decision we want to preserve our forests for future generations, which means we need to take care of those forests. We applied sound principles of scientific forest management and trimmed the forests to assure that to match the tree population to the ability of the land to support that population. That produced healthy, vital, vibrant forests that were resistant to pestilence, disease, drought, and ultimately to catastrophic wildfire. Unfortunately, back in the early 70s, we passed laws that have made the scientific management of our forests virtually impossible. The National Environmental Policy Act, the Endangered Species Act, have added such burdens to the management of our forests that that management no longer takes place. We've seen an 80% decline in timber harvested off of the federal forests over those years. And not coincidentally, we've seen a concomitant increase in acreage destroyed by forest fire. An old forester put it this way quite clearly. He said, you know, all that excess timber comes out of the forest one way or the other. It's either carried out or it burns out, but it comes out. When we carried it out, we not only had healthy, resilient forests, we also had a thriving economy based upon the timber industry. Since we passed those laws, we've seen enormous economic damage to our mountain communities, but in addition to that, we've seen enormous environmental damage to our national forests. A typical acre in the Sierra will support between 20 and 100 trees, depending upon the topography. Our current tree density is 266 trees per acre, so we're carrying roughly three times the density that the land can support. So these trees no longer have room to grow. They're fighting for their lives against other trees trying to occupy the same ground. That means they're constantly stressed, which means that you have an additional stress factor like a drought or a beetle infestation or disease hit that forest. It is absolutely devastating. The trees don't have the condition where they can defend themselves against these stressors, and we end up with massive tree mortality. So right. I would suggest, after 45 years of experience with these laws, that were all imposed with the promise that they would improve the forest environment, I think we're entitled to ask, how's the forest environment doing? And the answer is damning. These laws have not only failed to meet their objectives, they have been counterproductive to those objectives. They've done enormous harm to our forests. You know, we were told, well, you have to preserve all of the old growth timber. Well, there's a problem with that. An entomologist, in fact, several appeared before our subcommittee on federal lands that I chair this year and pointed out that's what causes the swarming. What you've done is to create forests that specifically could not be better designed to produce swarming activity by bark beetles, as just one example. And oddly enough, all of the endangered species habitats, the owl habitats, well, they made it impossible to go in and thin those environments. So they are prime targets for disease, for pestilence, and ultimately for catastrophic wildfire. I believe it was the King Fire alone. Maybe it was the Rim. I get them sometimes mixed up in my head. Well, we've had so many of them recently. Yeah. We've lost over 1,100 square miles of forest just in this district alone in the last 4 years to fire. So there's been a lot of it. But one of those fires took out, I believe the figure was 80 spotted owl habitats, absolutely incinerated them, because the laws that were supposed to protect those owl habitats made it impossible for us to thin and manage them. And so they were completely destroyed.
That's incredible. Now, does the Resilient Federal Forest Act, is it simply an amendment to these other laws? Is it a repeal of them?
Well, it does a number of things, but at the center of it, it grants a categorical exclusion from the National Environmental Policy Act to projects designed to thin the forests to provide for fire protection. One of the biggest problems we have is in order to go in there and do a thinning project, you've got to do years of environmental studies at enormous cost. Mm-hmm. It used to be our foresters would go in there, identify surplus timber, and then we'd auction it off. We'd say, how much do you folks want to pay us for this timber? And the highest bidder came in and removed the timber that the foresters of the U.S. Forest Service had designated as surplus. This wasn't a random thing. Mm-hmm. And that produced a major stream of revenues into the federal treasury. They were paying us for our timber. So they literally paid us to maintain our federal forests. That meant not only additional money that we could then use to improve the forests, local communities like this get 25% of the proceeds of that. This was, and not to mention all of the spin-off commercial activity of the folks that run the sandwich shops and the gas stations and everything else that support a thriving economy. All of that was lost with these laws, and we need to get them back, not only for the sake of our economy, but most importantly, for the environmental health of our forests.
How does something that's working so well get changed and go bad? Here we had a system that generated revenue, generated healthy forests, generated local economic growth, and yet somebody from the outside apparently decided that that was a bad idea.
Yeah, well,
somewhere along the line.
It was a bad idea, and being human, we make mistakes, and our institutions, which are human institutions, make mistakes too. And one of the biggest problems that we've had is that we're also wired in such a way that once we make our mistake, the more we invest in our mistakes, the less willing we are to admit them.
Right.
So this has been going on for 45 years now. It has proven to be an abject failure. 2 years ago, the census of dead trees in the Sierra, I believe, was about 25 million. It doubled to 50 million 2 years ago. Last year, this past year, they're estimated over 106 million dead trees. Those who blame the drought, yes, the drought was the final stressor. But trees that are in a healthy environment, that are properly managed, can easily resist a drought. Mm. The problem is when you've got 266 trees crammed into a single acre, and again, that's the average tree density in the Sierra, that water's gone in a flash, and you have problems even in normal rainfall years, and in a drought, it's devastating.
Well, we can see that this legislation would fix a tremendous amount of that.
It would allow us to start thinning our forests again. When I was at the command center for the Rough Fire a couple of years ago, that was the one that threatened Yosemite. I asked the firefighters there, what message can I take to Congress in your name? Mm-hmm. And they immediately said two words: treatment matters. Where the land is properly treated, the fire slowed, it began to break up, we could put it out. But they said there's just not enough of it. And that was the complaint that I just heard from firefighters at the Detweiler fire just a few weeks ago. Treatment matters. We don't have enough of it. In fact, these laws have made it impossible for us to do the controlled burns and cutting the fire breaks in advance of a fire, before a fire starts, so that we know that we can contain it.
This seems like a no-brainer. With the Republican shift in Congress and the mandate you've essentially been given, that it should sail through both houses.
Well, that act has been passed by the House in the two previous sessions. It's already passed the House Natural Resources Committee. I expect it'll be taken up on the House floor within the next several months. It will go over to the Senate, and unless the Senate reforms its cloture rule, it will end up just like the two bills that we sent to the Senate before it. We have a dysfunctional half of the legislative branch, and the legislative branch simply cannot function with one House simply unable to take up business because of its outdated cloture rule.
A close sister to, say, forest environmental issues is water control. And the U.S. Constitution talks about federal control and regulation of navigable waters, which in my lay.
Well, not the Constitution. The Constitution does not discuss that.
It doesn't mention navigable waters.
We have jurisdiction over navigable waters. The EPA was granted authority over navigable waters.
And where I was going with this thought is they've gone to a point of they seem to believe that gives them authority over all water. And weren't there some court cases that said, water runs into navigable waters?
It's important to make that distinction. In the 111th Congress, this was the Nancy Pelosi, Harry Reid Congress. The EPA decided we're not satisfied with jurisdiction over just navigable waterways, which is pretty easy to identify.
I would think so.
We want jurisdiction over all waterways. So they did it the right way. They brought a bill to the Congress to give them that jurisdiction. The Pelosi Congress refused to adopt it. So what did they do? They decided, well, we don't need no stinking laws. We'll just make one up ourselves. We'll redefine our jurisdiction ourselves. Well, now, that runs absolutely afoul of the separation of powers that has protected our liberty for 250 years. I mean, at the very core of our Constitution is this notion that we separate the powers of government. One organ makes decisions, an entirely separate organ enforces them, and an entirely separate organ from those two adjudicates any disputes that arise from them. And Article 1, which is the first article of the Constitution, obviously. It's also the longest article. It's almost half of the entire document. Begins with the words, all legislative powers herein granted are vested in a Congress of the United States. The Congress, representing the people, is there to actually make laws. And it's a frustrating system because they wanted it hard to make decisions. They wanted an issue held up to every conceivable light. They wanted a great, big, ugly debate over an issue before a decision that was made on behalf of all of the American people. That's why that legislative power is reserved solely to the Congress. Once that decision's made, then they wanted it efficiently carried out by one hand. That's the president. The president is commanded to take care that the laws be faithfully executed. What the EPA did was to usurp the legislative authority that created it and simply make up additional jurisdictions. That is absolutely intolerable. The federal courts have blocked that. The House has now voted to rescind that authority. That's the good news is that our system still works more often than it doesn't. But we really are reaching a point where the federal bureaucracy is taking on a life of its own, and not only executing laws, it's also making laws, and it is adjudicating those laws, as we talked about in another segment. The same branch of government that makes the law now gets to enforce it. If it accuses you of breaking it, you don't have immediate access to the federal courts, where all your due process rights are protected under our Constitution. Instead, you are tried in an administrative court run by the same agency that wrote the law, enforced the law, accused you of breaking the law, and by the way, gets to keep the fines that it assesses on you without congressional oversight.
Congressman, this has been a fantastic time with you, and I think both myself, and I think I can speak for our viewers too, I think we feel very fortunate to have you representing us in Washington.
You.
And I hope that that remains the case for a long, long time. Thank you again for joining us, and thank you all for watching. And Congressman, keep up the good work.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Corey,
it's been a pleasure. Thanks so much for having me.